only 28 responded so far. Which means that third of students are yet to join. If anyone is not able to see the poll, please send a chat message immediately. Okay, let's move forward. Three-fourths are present, one-fourth missing. Okay. Good morning to you all and welcome back. Today we are going to discuss the fourth part of MAJVCEG. We are in module one so far. Today, our focus would be on leveraged buyouts. But before we move to discuss leveraged buyouts, which is basically associated with PE firms, private equity firms, we would see a summary of the previous session case, which is Tyco. And after that, we'll discuss some of the conceptual aspects of leveraged buyouts. And then we will move to discuss the case of Endo. After the break, right? To move to discuss the previous case, which was Tyco, we know that Tyco had a problem in 1995. CII ranked it among the 20 worst performing companies based on 1 or 2 years of stock price situation. Using a mechanical formula. But then Tyco did not agree with it because Tyco's fundamentals were strong. But of course, from 1992 onwards, Tyco strengthened its fundamentals, particularly after Denis Kozlowski took over as the CEO. But that doesn't wipe out what happened during 91, 92, 93 immediately. As a result, we find a situation where there is some justification for CII's ranking and there is some justification for Tyco's objection to that ranking. Both, we faced a situation where both were correct. Accordingly, our position was that if CII has to roll over the ranking for subsequent years, say for instance, 92, 96, 93, 97, etc. Probably the latest ranking for 97, using 93, 97 would be much more favorable to Tyco because the stock was performing well and the fundamentals were also good. That is how we concluded the session discussion on Tyco's case. So here we could split the question into two, that is, was CII's ranking itself justified and did it reflect Tyco's fundamentals? So when we examine the first point, we find that yes, justified because it's a mechanical formula using very clear parameters. And those parameters were not in Tyco's favor, particularly in the initial couple of years, 91, 92, 93 period, there was a fluctuation in the stock performance. So the mechanical formula of CII is just reflecting that, and CII cannot be blamed for that because they don't use a lot of subjective justifications, etc. That is every company's problem, whichever is affected, that company's problem, but not CII's formula problem. Therefore, both parts are correct. That is the situation. So we asked, was CII 95 ranking of Tyco justified? From the mechanical formula point of view, yes, we found it was justified. CII ranking was formula based. CII ranking was neutral for all firms. So they did not do anything particular against Tyco. It was just a neutral formula applied to everybody. Worst 20 ranking was a neutral outcome coming from the mechanical formula. it was independent of Tycho's justifications because those were subjective and they belonged to the post 93 period, particularly after 92, taking over by Denis Kozlowski. It was independent of Tycho's justifications. Tycho was aware of his 91, 92 data. So it should not object because it knew there was a problem. And the moment that data is fed for a 5-year ranking, automatically that formula will give that kind of a result. Even his 92, 97 results were below its goal. Tycho's reaction is normal of an affected firm. So there is nothing wrong in Tycho objecting to this and protesting. Every affected company will be doing that only. They will try to justify their position in front of the investors and the media. Maybe it is not intended for CII. It is intended for the investors, prospective investors, and the media, as well as general public. So that is the situation with respect to the mechanical ranking by CII. And we also find here the behavior of the data. If you look at the exhibits, we will find the behavior of the data like this. You can see there is a fluctuation. So if we take the first 5 years data, 91, 92, 93, 94, 95, we will find the trend line is almost parallel to x-axis with a very slight slope. That is because the trend is not stable. It is just dipping to a very low level and then going up after 93. So if we take a 93, 97 kind of situation, trend line will be continuously positive, steeply positive. So we can very clearly see a 97 ranking will definitely be very good for Tycho, but not the ranking of 91, 95 because there is a 92, 93 dip in that. So that is the kind of situation. And we also accommodated the fact that the share was split into two. And we have doubled that. 1.5 is 3 because of the split. 2 is 4 and 2.5 is 5. So considering that after 93, we will have a 5-year continuous increase with a reasonably steep slope, which means 93, 95, 5-year period will be giving a positive result for Tycho in CII ranking. But not 91, 95 or 92, 96 because the dip is there in 93. So that is the situation we find in favor of CII's ranking. But when we look at the fundamentals of Tycho, we will be finding many factors. Did CII's 95 ranking of Tycho reflect its fundamentals? No, because it had a superior past of performance, particularly recent past, and a distant past. Its lean and efficient corporate structure, its very high 4-year earnings growth, Lehman's report of its strong fundamentals, Lehman's report of its best business mix, its sound strategic practices, its focused approach to acquisition and operations, and its post-1992 profit performance. All this would indicate that its fundamentals are strong, and the CII ranking of 95, including the earlier fluctuation years, is not reflecting fundamentals. Therefore, the subsequent years ranking reflecting the fundamentals would be much better for, much favorable to Tycho. So that is the conclusion we will be getting. Okay. So you can raise any issues, ask questions, clarifications. You can have your own statements, observations. Of course, you can also see this one particular one. That is, what were the success factors of Tycho's growth, diversification, acquisition-based growth? That is, acquisitions are not expected to be accretive right away, not revenue enhancing. They would be profit enhancing, right? The costs are tried to be squeezed out as quickly as in weeks. So their integration process and synergy realization process is very fast. There would be hard pushing for revenue enhancement. There would be hard pushing for every time they would try to get the returns very quickly, right? Only businesses known and understood are targeted for acquisition. So they don't get into unknown businesses. That is bolt-on business, platform business, filling in complementary business. These are the kind of businesses they were looking for. Operating divisions propose acquisitions, not corporate office. So operating divisions are identifying the opportunities. So they will only identify what will add to their accretive to their return, right? Net income, not revenue. Therefore, they don't go for growth of size, but they look for growth of income, net income, that is returns. Yeah. So that you can consider as the positive factors on for Tyco's strong fundamentals and success. Yeah, Chitrang, you wanted to say something?
So yeah, I had one question. Like we are discussing this case from the perspective like CII ranked Tyco on the 20 worst performing firms. So sir, what is the significance of this rating, and are there like we, as you just said that it is more mechanical, like last 5-4 years data will be used and some formula will be used to calculate it. So are there any other competitive agencies which also encapsulate the future growth perspective, like qualitative as well as quantitative, in order to rate certain companies in a better way, sir?
See, we need to consider two sources of fluctuations in the valuation of the company. Stock price, you know, is a discounted valuation of its expected performance in the years to come. Immediate years would be first influencing, but distant years would be having an bearing, right? But distant years is not some 20, 30 years. It would be just 3 to 5 or 3 to 7, 5 to 7 kind of years, right? Because beyond that, it is not known. So there are two sources of fluctuation in the valuation of the company. One is the internal actions. That is internal, how strong their internal actions are strategically, operationally, and so on. How profitable they are likely to be because of the internal actions. The second is the external forces. For instance, there are many crises coming. Suddenly, COVID crisis came. The business prospect of many companies went down. So, stock price will also go down. Suddenly, there is some tragedy like that is an earthquake and the factory was destroyed, or fire like Serum Institute. Suddenly, factory was destroyed because of the fire, or new building was destroyed. There will be a subsequent lowering of discounting process in the stock prices, right? So because it will take time for them to again recoup the losses in that. So in the meantime, their assets are destroyed. So if Fukushima kind of tragedy comes, GE's nuclear energy business will be discounted. So like that, there are many external factors. Along with that, there are also factors like economic slowdown. There was an oil crisis. Oil crisis will affect business prospects. So that will also be reflected in the stock price if this particular business is affected by the oil price. And in the same way, when economic slowdown happens, there would be demand decline. And for next year, maybe 1 or 2 or 3 years, depending upon the length of the economic cycle, there will be impact on this company's business revenues, profits, and so on. Therefore, valuation will also be affected. So external sources, external factors will be one source of the impact on value, means valuation, stock prices. Internal performance, including operation, strategy, all this would be one source. And internal will also be affected by the uncertainties at the leadership level, like suppose CEO is not able to perform well, or there is a possibility of CEO being thrown out, or there is a possibility of another good CEO, Jack Welch kind of CEO coming in. All those will also be incorporated into the stock expectation, stock price expectation about this company. So in this particular case, Tyco's case, there was a steep increase in the stock price, and then suddenly the scenario changed. Maybe external factors, because the case itself says some external issues were there. Maybe because of the internal factors, some changes occurred and the stock price came down, because that change, new changed scenario, which is not very rosy, that is also incorporated into the stock price. So in this case, we know very clearly that just before Denis Kozlovsky took over, or just around Denis Kozlovsky taking over, there was a dip in the stock price because of those kinds of factors, partly external factors, mostly it is external factors. So the stock market will reflect that, because stock holders are not continuously holding it for several years. For them, the value has to be realized when they are going to sell the share. So if they don't have a long horizon, they will be willing to share, sell the share if the gain is there or if the losses are likely to be there. So all those factors will be reflected in the stock price, Chitra. So we can't just conclude on the basis of the stock price fluctuations that everything has changed for the company from a longer run perspective. So many short run factors are also there. Plus, inexplicable factors will also be there. Rumor factors will be there. So that is the reason why nobody is able to predict the stock price movements in a very accurate way. All will be very approximate. Is that explaining what you asked, Chitra?
Yes, sir. So, sir, we also had like Sabra course. So there, it was more focused on CRA, credit rating agency. So they have some mechanical as well as some qualitative aspects also, like who are the promoters, how is the company going overall. So accompanying all those factors, we give some rating there. So I was just thinking, like, is there a similar process here in CII also after this process? Whatever has happened with
that. One is the base factors, then the rating and the stock prices will be continuously adjusted for all the changes happening, right? Credit rating may not be adjusted so quickly, looking at the short run factors, random factors, but stock market adjustment happens very quickly. Looking at the random factors. Random factors happen all the time. Even a gossip rumor can affect as a random factor. So stock price adjustment is much faster than the credit rating.
Yes, sir.
Even daily, weekly factors are affecting the stock prices. Credit rating may not be affected so fast. Maybe at least a few weeks, quarters, months may be taken in adjustment. Surya. Surya.
Sir, yeah. So my question is, CII put them in the top 20 worst performing companies, and basically, if it's not indicating the fundamentals, then what credibility does CII have, and why are the investors running around trying to defend that their practices are sound if it doesn't reflect the fundamentals in the first place?
The reason is that, you know, it is like a business school ranking. We know what is going on in business school, but still if some external factors are influencing the business school ranking and some business school gets a higher ranking, you know, candidates will run for those schools as first preference, right? That is why every business school is concerned about the ranking. Same thing is true about the global university rankings, right? So the people who don't know all the details, internal details of the company, will get influenced by certain indicators. And this kind of agency rankings would be indicators like a credit rating, which Chitrang was saying. So credit rating will indicate to people how strong this company is, whether that credit rating, like Moody's. Moody's, you remember recently in the middle of the corona, they reduced the rating of India. And I always believed that that was unfair because India was able to manage better than some of the other countries, but still they did not reduce it for others, but for India. And I had a fear that maybe this some of the international agencies are now more manned by people, means the officials from China. Many of those international agencies have a lot of people from China, or they are also influenced by China due to financial factors, because China is much stronger than India. Therefore, just to prevent the investor exodus from China and just to prevent the investor coming to India against China, I think some underlying factors might have worked, or some deliberate efforts might have been there. So all those factors will be affecting this kind of ranking. But the moment this ranking comes out or this kind of rating comes out, immediately people will look at that and decide that, okay, India's situation is bad, so we should not go to India. Let's go to other places like Vietnam or China, whoever got a better rating. So that is the problem with this. That is why every company has to defend it. You see, you may be that is because of 1 year, but we are very strong, and in the coming years, we are going to generate a lot of value for the shareholders, so that the prospective buyers of Tyco shares will not go away, financiers will not go away. You understand, Surya?
Yes, sir.
It is in their interest to reassure the investors and the other funding agencies, as well as the general public, that No, our company is very strong. This doesn't reflect our fundamentals, economic fundamentals or financial fundamentals. Therefore, don't get scared. We are very strong. We are going to give you value. It is also part of an organization's viable position in the market as well as their standing, that branding and standing. Any other question or comment? Any other question? No? No comment? Move forward? Okay. So moving forward, I just provide you some data about Tyco later. In 2011, Tyco was split into multiple operations. Of course, 2011 revenue was 17.4 billion. Profit also was substantial, more than 10%, 11-12%. But one major thing that happened, of course, in 1997, Tyco had merged with a smaller ADT, smaller company called ADT Limited to become its subsidiary. But ADT adopted the name Tyco International. In 2005, VSNL acquired Tyco Global Network. VSNL means our now with the Tata Telecom. Its headquarters is partly in Ireland and partly in USA. These changes happened subsequently. And Tyco was also subject to frequent controversies and restructuring. And finally, what happened was, Denis Kozlowski left Tyco in 2002, right? He was subsequently jailed for various financial actions as CEO. Although financial performance of Tyco during his later half was appreciated by Wall Street as Tyco became a mega conglomerate through 1,000 acquisitions. 1,000 is a misnomer, but it's a claim. 1,000 acquisitions. But you can see that his financial dealings led to some scandal and he was jailed in 2005 for various financial actions as CEO. So you can see that Tyco, everything was not, although they claimed all the fundamentals are strong and they did everything, but everything was not non-controversy. And that is best manifested in the jailing of CEO Denis Kozlowski itself. So what do you say about this? Now I want your comments. What do you think? Because some of us were very vociferous saying that their fundamentals are strong and why not? So what do you think in light of this particular development related to Tyco? And Tyco was also split into multiple operations in 2011. Any question or comment or any anguish you want to express? Anyone? Particularly those who had conviction that yes, everything was good about Tyco at that point of time. 97. No, no comments?
So one question about the CEO being jailed, like what could be the reason? Was it the bonus and incentives? Like he had different plateaus, some three plateaus were there and high bonuses were given. So could that be related to this factor or what else?
I will suggest Chitrang just do some Google Uncle question and you will get it was very controversial because some of the many things happened, not just that reward itself, but the financial, that valuation, several mergers, acquisitions were done and how the financing was done, valuation was done. So many issues were there. And Abhik Datta is also saying accounting fraud. But all these were related to their mergers, acquisition and all those related actions. Right? Yeah. Srikanta is giving additional information, but it was not just one small issue. It was many aspects, particularly related to his frequent acquisition actions and valuation. A lot of issues were there. And how the results were projected, all those were there. Because these kind of people, CEOs who are very ambitious, have a need to project always a better image to the stock market, where then only the stock performance will continue. And the market image to investors and many other stakeholders. So all those were involved. You have got two pieces of information from Avik and Srikanta, right? Okay. So I hope you have, Avik, you have more information to provide to Chitra? Of course, if you do a Google search, you will get all that. Google Anglia is very generous from that point of view. No? Okay, moving forward, if you don't have any question or comment, let's move forward. Okay. Moving forward, we will discuss about the leveraged buyouts. Leveraged buyouts may be familiar to you because in finance papers, probably there might have been a reference. But definitely in the economic newspapers, you might have been frequently seeing the case of companies which are called private equity firms like KKR, Carlyle, Blackstone, Bain Capital. A lot of companies are there, right? All these companies may be familiar to you. Many of you have a financial orientation, and in financial management courses, they might have touched upon some of these aspects. So today we are looking at this LBO process a little more, right? You want to say anything about LBOs from your own knowledge point of view? Knowledge, using your own knowledge? Anyone who heard about LBO or private equity firms who worked with some of these people? Anyone? No one? You have not heard about private equity firms and LBO in your financial papers or in any of the other places?
Yes, sir, we have. It is the acquisition of firms funded primarily by debt. That's why it's called leverage, because you leverage the firm with debt. The debt ranges from 50 to 80%, whereas the rest funding is from it. That's
Yeah,
leverage.
that is the leverage part indicates the debt part. Yes, that is a characteristic. Second.
Yes, sir. Also, because of the high amount of debt, basically they're amplifying the returns by taking up money that is not their own. So the scope of returns is a lot, but the scope of losses is also just as high. So
Yeah,
it is a high risk strategy as
correct.
such.
So there are many aspects involved here. Number one, as both of you said, there is a high debt content. It's a leveraged buyout. Who will buy? Generally, what would happen is that it is a management buyout. Leveraged buyout in many cases would be management buyout. But the management itself may not be able to completely finance this because it would be running into hundreds of millions of dollars unless it's a small company, very small company. In that case, they will invariably seek the support of the private equity firms. So private equity firms will put the maximum equity. And a part of equity will be taken by the management. If it is within the reach of management itself can do the buyout, right? So in that case, management will raise as much equity as possible, and balance could be the debt raised from market. But in the case of whenever private equity firms are involved, definitely that will be a lot of leverage. That is because using somebody else's money, as Srikanth said, using somebody else's money. They will be making their own returns. But how is it possible? As he said, there is a high risk because you are raising a lot of debt, means you have a lot of debt service obligation. Your cash flow is pledged for servicing the debt, which means you need to have high cash flow. So all the cash flow will be used for servicing debt. And when a leveraged buyout is done, there will be an horizon for exit. A private equity firm will always sell out. It will never continue with the firm. Only by selling out, it will be able to realize the returns. How does it realize the return? Leveraged buyouts will always be private firms, private limited firms. It is on their own, and it is not sellable. The equity is not sellable or saleable in the market. So it is a private limited firm. And all shares will be owned by the private equity firm and management. In management, to the extent management has participated in the equity. But the total equity itself would be a small fraction of the total capital. A large fraction of the capital will be raised through debt. And the private equity firms will have a horizon, a stay horizon of about 3 to 10 years. 10 years in the extreme case, generally 3 to 5 years. After 3 to 5 years, whatever their horizon of staying, they will be selling out. That is, their part will be either through an IPO or an arrangement with another buyer. That will be their part will be sold out. and management also will be able to sell out their shares at that point of time, right? And whatever gains are there, that they can realize. Now, it is necessary that in an LBO firm, the cash flow is very high. That is, the profitability is very high. Particularly, the gross profits are very high. Because we know it is from gross profits, they will have to repay the interest and then the principal. The interest and principal will have to be completely repaid for all the capital to be realized for the private equity firm's gain. So if 100 is the value of the firm, and say 25 is the equity, 75 will be the debt. And from the cash flow of a 3 to 5 year horizon, the operations will have to completely repay the interest obligations and the 75 capital, means the debt. And at the end of these 3 to 5 years, maximum debt should be repaid, if possible the full, which means at the end of 3 years or 5 years, if all the debt and the interest obligations are paid out, the total value of 100 is fully realized by the private equity firm and whoever contributed the equity, which means 25 was the equity you have invested, but now your valuation will be 100 because the debt is already paid off, which means on 25, you are getting 75 return, which means a 3x return you will be getting. The total value now is, compared to your equity, 4x, out of which 1x was your equity, 3x will be the return. So that is how the private equity firms will be generating huge returns. And to ensure that, what they will be doing is that they will not normally disrupt the management. The same management will be continued if they are competent. And the private equity firms will have a lot of experience to handhold the management. So the managers will be supported, they will be guided, they will be helped in preparing plan for the enhanced performance of the firm. And with the help of private equity firms' advice, the managers will run the firm. And private equity firms are only portfolio investors. They are not operating investors. They don't do operating management. They are only portfolio management. Therefore, they will hold the portfolio, advise the managers. They will be guided. They will be helped in making appropriate plans and targets and goals. But managers will be running the firm. And if the past managers who continued are not competent, or they are not private equity investors, are not happy with the management, they will mercilessly replace the management and they will bring in new management. And that management is expected to meet all the obligations, all the target requirements, performance requirements. So if everything worked out well, at the end of 5 years, all the cash flows were generated as expected and the debt is all paid off. If no cash flow is, cash reserve is balanced, then we know that 100 divided by 25, that is the total value now, which is 3x return. If more profit was generated, more cash, some cash reserve will also be there. That also is owned by the private equity firm who owns the company. So the valuation will be accordingly elevated. So it will go up to 5x, 6x, 10x, 12x, and so on. So that is how the return will be generated. The private equity firms will not run, will not operate the company. They are only portfolio managers. They will be operating the companies through the management. But managers will be guided and mentored, and they will be helped in making plan. And if the management is not doing well, they will replace the management. The new management will be running the company better. That is how the private equity firms operate. And that is the way they do the leveraged buyouts. And in leveraged buyouts, in most of the cases, in almost all the cases, management equity will be involved. The reason is that only if management owns the equity, they will have motivation to perform well. That is the way private equity firms will also get a multi-x return. That is why they would like as many employees as possible getting equity holding here. And generally, up to 20% of equity will be given to the management and employees, right? But of course, in some, it can go up a little higher also to 25, 30, 30, 35, and so on. But generally, 20% would be the equity that allowed for, maximum allowed for management and other employees. And private equity firms would generally like maximum employees taking the equity, because then employees will have a lot of motivation to get best results. Thereby, private equity firms will also be better off. That is the preface. Then we will go step by step. Okay. So to understand the leveraged buyout, we also need to know the types of acquisitions. We know merger is one type of acquisition. Of course, for some acquisitions are packaged as merger for tax purposes. When merging, there are certain tax possibility, tax saving possibilities. So companies would be packaging acquisitions as mergers. Like even in the case of Tyco in 1997, they did the same thing with ADT. ADT was a small company. So to get some tax break and tax saving, etc., they did the, that kind of thing, that reverse merger, whereby ADT is absorbing Tyco, and then the joint entity will be using Tyco International name that way. And the second is the friendly acquisition, where it will be easier to manage the company after acquisition because the management and employees will be generally friendly with the acquiring company. The third is the hostile raid, hostile takeover, corporate raid. For instance, East India Hotels Oberoi sells 14.8% stock in 2011 to Reliance to ward off ITC takeover when ITC already had such an ownership share in East India Hotels. So you can see this kind of thing. When ITC wanted to do a hostile takeover through corporate raid, East India Hotels Oberoi saved itself from that kind of a thing by giving an equal percentage of stake to Reliance so that both will be equalized and the other will not be able to take over. So that is how the hostile takeover will be one route. In the Tyco case also, we know Gassiano had tried this kind of hostile takeover bit, but not always it will be successful. For instance, just to illustrate that, I have given this Oberoi Hotel example. That could, the ITC could not succeed, right? And the other type of takeover, I mean, the acquisition is the leveraged buyout, which will be either done by management or by the private equity firms. Man, if management does it completely, it is called management buyout. But even in management buyout, the private equity firms may be invited if management doesn't have the full equity with them if company is large. So management buyout could be a partial leveraged buyout by private equity firms. But in smaller cases, management alone may be able to do the management buyout, right? But in most of the management buyouts, private equity firms would be involved because management may not be capable of raising so much of equity, right? So that is how the types of acquisitions. And defining LBO, we can borrow some definitions from OECD, etc., and we can expand that. I have modified it slightly. So you can see a buyout refers to a situation where the existing owners of a firm are bought out by another group, usually a private equity firm or management and or workers of that firm. A buyout refers to a situation where the existing owners of a firm are bought out by another group, usually a private equity firm or management and or workers of that firm. A buyout may be for the whole firm or a division or a plant as the case applies. And it depends upon what the existing owners want to sell. The existing owners may not want to sell the whole thing. They may just want to do harvesting. Harvesting means whatever part they think will fetch high value that they may like to sell. Or whatever part they don't want to keep, they may sell that and realize what maximum value possible from the market. So that is how the leveraged buyout happens. It could be management, workers, or a private equity firm. But if management is doing that, it is particularly known as the management buyout. The financing of the buyout can be structured in various ways, such as bank loans or through the issuance of bonds, like junk bond, etc., which is not secured, but which carries a large interest to compensate for the insecured nature of that. So junk bonds, it could be junk bonds, or it could be preference kind of thing. That is convertible bonds. Convertible bond means now it is a debt instrument, but later on, if you want it, the issuer can convert it into equity. So convertible bonds also can be there. So when it is a bond, its interest is very clearly specified. But when it is converted, it will be subject to all the valuations of the company. In a leveraged buyout, for example, a fairly large proportion of debt in relation to the asset value of the firm is incurred. Because buyouts lead to replacing publicly traded equity with the debt in the form of bonds backed by assets and or guarantees, the firms are often viewed as going private. That is, when leveraged buyout happens, the private public limited companies will be converted into private limited company. Why? Because the private equity firm or the management will be completely buying out the equity from the other player. Therefore, from many players, it all went to one player or a few players, and it becomes a private limited company. Therefore, because buyouts lead to replacing publicly traded equity with the debt in the form of bonds backed by assets and other guarantees, the firms are often viewed as going private since its shares may no longer be listed on the stock exchange. Buyouts are viewed as an integral part of the market for corporate control and the redeployment of assets from lower to higher valued users. So I have given a detailed explanation here to make it very clear. Even whatever I said a few minutes before captured all that I said here in these sentences, but still I have given these sentences so that in a nutshell you can get what I have been explaining in the past few minutes. So do you have any clarification related to this definition or the explanation I have given? Any of you? The previous one slide or this one, the definition of LBO by OECD adapted and the explanation. Anyone? No? No question? No comment? No clarification? Ask something. You're all there, right? You're not sleeping, I suppose, because you people, many of you had a lot of activities, including games, etc. I hope none of you is sleeping. At least say no, 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 we are not sleeping. No. Okay. Siganta.
Sir, I just had one question. Why are PE firms able to access such a high amount of debt? I mean, what sets them apart from the company itself?
That is, they have many methods of getting it. It is not that they all will be like the traditional firm. Traditional firm has many checks and balances, right? They will not go for high risk investment, right? In this case, what happens is that they are specialized in guiding the management. Private equity firms are generally considered to be very good in short-run value creation, short-run management, because they will replace the management. If the existing management is not competent to achieve what they want, they will replace. So because of that expertise in finding, locating good potential assets and their ability to turn around the management, turn around the company fortunes, there is a general belief that whatever is lent out to them will be recovered, right? And when they create value in 3 years, 5 years, they will be just leaving the investment and they will be able to realize the value because of that 3 year, 5 year exit provision. So yes. Before that, within this 3 years, 4 years, the debt obligations will have to be paid out from the cash flow. So it is expected that adequate cash flow is generated and private equity firms will not go and take companies, buy companies which don't have the capacity to generate that kind of cash flow. So they make a good analysis of where potentially is there, where cash flow can be generated, where the debt can be paid off. So everybody following this kind of leading private equity firms like KKR or Carlyle or Blackstone or Bain Capital, etc., know that they have the competence to generate that kind of cash. That could be the reason why these people are able to generate so much of debt. And the other thing is that there are many firms which are specializing in junk bonds. They are willing to take a lot of risk with a lot of return also. So for their debt, junk bond debt issue, the interest expectation will be very high. And they are also taking risk because it's all insecure. So in the process, what happens is that 80% or 90% or 95% of the time, they will be able to get their repayment. But in 5% of the cases, they may lose also. Yes. There is no problem, 10%, etc. Because their return is very high, you know, probability, we apply probability for this kind of situation. That is, there is a chance of 80% coming out with such a high reward and 20% fail, which means zero or minus. Therefore, what is the expected payoff? So in this kind of investment, the expected payoff is very high. And many of these players are going by that expected payoff probability and the expected return. Is that clear, Sikandar?
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
And more information will come in the subsequent slides. Okay. So look at this. This is the structure of the private equity firm. There is a technicality in the private equity firm. Actually, it is a little complicated. You have to pay attention to what I'm saying. Private equity firm is a firm which is managed by a general partner. Private equity firm is a firm which is managed by a general partner, right? And what they do is they approach many investors, right? I'm explaining, Srikanth, I am explaining your point further, right?
Yes.
They will approach many investors, prospective investors, like who are mutual funds and other capital funds, like public pension funds, corporate pension funds, insurance companies, high net worth individuals, family offices, endowments, foundations, all these I have named there, right? So they will approach this for commitment, right? They will not take the money. They will only seek commitment. Suppose the private equity firm wants to put 100 million in a certain type of investment, say in manufacturing companies. Say for instance, suppose in the manufacturing sector, some selected manufacturing sector, they want to invest 100 million. So they will create a fund of 100 million, but they will not take the money. They will go and get the commitment from all these fund providers. Then they will look for the opportunities. Suppose an opportunity came for some 50 million investment in a particular, that is leveraged by out, in a particular very prospective manufacturing investment, right? So in that case, what they will do is to invest in that, they will form a limited liability partnership. To invest in that manufacturing opportunity, which is very prospective, 50 million is the investment required. They will go for a limited liability partnership for that particular investment. And then they will approach all the people who have committed and they have become the limited partners. In that limited liability partnership, all of them, whoever is contributing, suppose five different funds contributed 10 million each, 10 million each, then they are all five limited partners. Limited partners, of course, in this particular example, with all equal partnership. So that 50 million will be available to the private equity firm for investment, right? And the general partner will be the one who will be managing that investment. And the limited partners don't have any say. They sign a limited partnership agreement with their private equity firm. And all the terms and conditions of this 10 million given to them as a limited partner will be governed by that particular limited liability partnership agreement signed with each of the five players contributing 10 million, 10 million each. And you know, every investment, limited partnership investment, limited liability partnership investment will have a horizon of liquidation. Say for instance, suppose this 50 million investment in one limited liability partnership, limited partnership has a horizon of 10 years. So at the end of 10 years, this partnership will have to be liquidated. Beyond that, it cannot go by law, contract law. At the end of 10 years, this limited liability investment of partnership investment of 50 million will have to be liquidated and the money will have to be paid back to the five partners, limited partners. Okay. And from this investment, whatever returns have been obtained from that 50 million, that will have to go back to the partners and with some proportion. That is, I think 20% will straight away be deducted by the general partner, that is the private equity firm, for all their services. And then there will be some service charges also. 20% of the profit balance will go to them. And they will also have some service charges, right? After that, whatever is balanced, that will be distributed among the limited partners. So limited partners will get their capital return, plus they will also get the share of the profit generated in this. Suppose the private equity firm is liquidating this investment after 5 years or 7 years, there the 20% plus the service charges will go to private equity firm out of the profits. and the balance profit will be distributed among all the limited liability partners. And with that partnership is liquidated, right? That partnership is liquidated. That is only investment specific. Each partnership signed, the limited partnership signed is for specific investment. After that, it is liquidated, right? That is the way each of the investments will be planned under the private equity firm. Private equity firm consists of general partners who are just managing the investment, but actual money will come from the limited partners, and they will first give a commitment to the private equity firm on the basis of their discussion, and commitment letter will also be given. And then when an investment opportunity comes, they will be approached for that amount. If 50 million required, 50 million will be contributed by the different agreeing partners. And each agreement signed between the partner, prospective partner and private equity firm will last for a certain period, say 10 years. So that commitment automatically expires after 10 years, if 10 years was the period of commitment. Now, within these 10 years, private equity firm can find business opportunities and ask them to contribute that money and use that money and generate profits for them. But if any money is unused at the end of 10 years out of the money committed by these different investors, that if 10 years is the horizon of the partnership agreement, the commitment agreement, that automatically gets nullified. After that, something new will have to happen, which means for each of the investments, there will be different agreement, and the overall commitment will end with that date coming, maybe 10 years ever. Is that clear? You can now see.
So I had a doubt. So what if the entity makes loss or doesn't make profit?
Sorry, once again?
So what if the private equity entity doesn't make any profit or goes into losses?
That is a chance. Then nothing can be done. Whatever profits means, losses will also go to them. Because it's an agreement. Na? There is no guaranteed return. Whatever profits are generated, that will. But only thing is that the one a private equity firm making losses will have a loss of market phase. Therefore, for them getting commitments in future will be difficult. Generally, it doesn't happen, but there have been cases. I don't exactly remember, but a few months ago, there was some case of some major investment failing with the private equity firm. It happens. I can tell you one more thing, that is Tata. You remember Tata Tetley, that merger? Even that has been an LBO thing, but that did not fail. But I'm saying there are cases, well-known cases where failure, I think a few months ago, there was one case where a failure was reported, something happened. But these are not normal, because private equity firms are generally very competent in management. They generally turn around. But when 100 investments are made or 50 investments are made, again, probability might work. Maybe 5% may lead to losses. Calculations can go wrong, or they may be over-enthusiastic about something. It can happen. But if somebody has committed $100 million and that has been put into some 5 investments, overall, if they make a profit, they may not be very much worried about that. But if all money is lost or part of the money is lost in all the investments made, then private equity firms will lose the market profile. And in future, for them, raising funds would be difficult. And fund providers also will not trust those firms. That private equity firms also know. That is why it doesn't happen frequently. Shalija.
Thank you, sir.
Chances are there, failure happens, money was lost, it happens. Because it's upfront business, you know, anything can happen at any point of time. But by and large, it doesn't happen because they are good to turn around people. They get it done through their monkey managers. They don't do it directly. And they replace the monkeys as and when required. And you can see here, the investment management would be coming from private equity firm, whereas the ownership of fund is with the limited partners. But of course, private equity firm will also contribute to equity, but it may be a small amount. They will also contribute to equity, but it may be a small amount. Most of it would be coming from the partners. And they will make a private equity fund for a specific purpose, and that will be used for investment. Say if it is, this fund was made for manufacturing, companies, they will do it only for that. And private equity firms generally have funds for different purposes, for Suppose the one fund may be only for manufacturing companies, another fund may be only for IT companies, another fund may be only for startup enterprises. Like that, they generally launch different funds to which they invite contribution from different partners, and they give commitment. As and when investment happens, they contribute money. That is the way it is done. Now, moving forward, this is the LBO process. A little more explained. I have taken all these from various sources, you can see here. And this one is taken from Wikipedia. I have scanned many sources to get appropriate relationships. Of course, some of them I have modified also. You can see some of them modified to make it more presentable. LBO process, that is, new investors will form a new company and lenders will provide cash. And debt is in their name, lender's name. And the target company will get cash and asset will be pledged to the new company, right? So new investors, they will formulate a new company for this particular investment. That particular company, investment limited liability partnership company, will invest in that target. Okay. And it is not that everything will be directly done by the private equity firm. Okay. It is a very complex process, right? Here. Like this here, commitment came, and for particular industries or particular types of investment, they formed a private equity fund. Now they will have to make an investment. How will they make the investment? They will make the investment like this. For that investment, particular investment, say, for instance, Tata Tetley has to be acquired through LBO. In that case, they will start a special purpose vehicle. This new company will be a special purpose vehicle only for this particular investment, right? And that would also be a limited partnership thing because the investors will have to put money into that. So that special purpose vehicle will raise that fund from various sources and they will get the target, right? Acquire the target. And when this target is liquidated, automatically this will also get liquidated later because it's a specific investment. Right? This I have taken from Abacus. Like that, different sources I have taken different things. Of course, I have modified many things. I have added illustration or explanation. And how does the LBO funding? Some of you asked earlier about the LBO process and the funding, how the funding goes to them. So you can see here that this is the way generally they would be packaging the funds, structuring the funds. The total value of the asset, 50% they generally, I mean, this is the general reasonable level they have kept, right? That is 50%, up to 50%, 50%, at least 50% would be coming from bank debt. Liabilities and shareholders' equity would be the second column. First column represents the total asset value. And on top, we will have senior, that is more secured debt. As we go downward, it will be more junior or unsecured debt, right? And the last one is equity. You can see equity, which is the most junior because there is no safety for that. If valuation goes, it goes. Bank debt is the most secured. That is why it is called the most senior debt. But because of the security of that, we must also know that expected returns will be low. And the quasi-equity mezzanine debt, that is, which will have debt and equity characteristics, after some time, it will be converted. It could be converted, right? Now it is debt, but later on it is convertible. That is why it is quasi-equity, which is also called mezzanine debt, right? And that generally would be up to 15%. High yield debt, junk bond and all that thing will be up to 15%. And equity, that return expected would be 20 to 40%, right? And you can see the key characteristics of each of this: low financing cost, lowest default risk, floating rate, sources, commercial banks, etc., leverage 1.5x to 3x, EBITDA, 7-year payback time, restrictive maintenance covenants, and so on. High yield debt, typically 10-year fixed rate loan, ability to defer cash interest payment in kind loan. Pricing, treasury equity plus 300, 600 basis points. has this one, quasi equity, has debt and equity characteristic, downward side protection like debt with upside potential like pure equity, because it's convertible. And common equity, you know very well, right? This is the way funding is structured. On an ideal basis, of course, the actual number will be different. Okay, this is the ideal basis. Actual number could be different. And you can see how Tata Tetley deal was structured. You can see Tata T, 60 million equity contributed. Tata T Incorporated, the USA contributed 10 million pounds. And Tata Sons contributed 1 million. That was the equity. Equity, total equity was 71 million pounds. Right? And the debt was 235 million. You can see almost 75% was debt. And the leverage ratio was 3.31:1. And there were four tranches. And the senior debt was given by Rabobank. You know, Rabobank was under some controversy. Last year or so, there was some news about Rabobank. Rabobank is a foreign-based, maybe Netherlands or Denmark-based connection. There is a connection with Denmark or Netherlands, Rabobank. Junior debt was with Intermediate Capital Group, PLC. They provided that debt. Okay. And the tenure was, this debt tenure was about 7 to 9.5 at LIBOR plus 424 basis points. That was the kind of servicing requirement, right? Rate. So this is the way in 2000 Tata Tetley deal was packaged. You can see the special purpose vehicle who was responsible for this. Tata T Great Britain, right? That was the company to acquire that, right? So that is how the leveraged buyouts are packaged. Now you can see a lot of names. You can see these names. You can see Apollo Global Management, Blackstone Group, Carlyle, KKR, Oak Tree, Fortress, Bain Capital, TPG, Warburg, Pincus. So you can see a lot of private funds are involved. Anybody is asking something? Anyone is asking something? Okay, so a lot of companies are involved. And you can see here the volume over a 5-year period, volume of exits, $1 billion, investments made by PE, backed buyouts, fundraising done in 2015, up to $200 billion funding was raised in PE backed buyouts, right? This is adapted from Bain and company. So like that, I have some data like this. Typical credit statistics of an LBO would be total debt to EBITDA multiple would be about 4.5 to 5.5x. Senior bank debt to EBITDA would be about 3x, right? Three times this of EBITDA. And EBITDA by interest coverage is expected greater than 2x. And net EBITDA after accounting for capex interest coverage should be ideally 1.6x. Okay, so these are the parameters that can change according to market conditions, but I am saying typical, these are the values reported in the literature, right? Or in the media. This is just for your information, what kind of relationships are there among the different financial parameters. And this is also a types of private equity investments, IRR return expectations. You can see angel investors, what they expect. Venture capital, what they expect, growth funds, what they expect, buyout firms, what they expect, distressed investing, what they expect. So you can see leveraged buyouts, the age of company could be 10 to 50 years, mezzanine debt could be 10 to 50 years, stage of company, public or private, private. Equity, how much equity requirement would be there. And finally, return expectations, you can see buyouts, return expectations would be anywhere between 25 to 40%, right? Whereas the maximum would be in the angel funds, you can see 70%. So depending upon the type of investment and the stage of investment, the return expectations and different parameters will change. But I just wanted to show the leveraged buyout in comparison with the other, right? Clear? So that is how. Then I have a little more data, of course. This is one important point. That is, when a company, private equity firm, exits the investment after 3 years or 5 years or 7 years, they have a cash on cash criteria. That is, value of equity investment at exit, value of initial equity investment. Say, for instance, suppose 100 was the value, 75 was the debt, 25 was the equity. So when the debt was fully paid off, when the exit happens, the value would be 100, full recovered equity value. So the value of equity at exit is 100 divided by value of equity at investment, that is 25. So cash on cash ratio will be 4x, right? Ideal value of cash on cash would be 2x to 5x. But in this example, we found 4x was the cash on cash ratio. So this is one important consideration for making investment. And it is also dependent on the debt content as well as the ability to repay using the cash flow, right? With that, I will stop this. Of course, some other points can be there, but we have taken out all the time. Yeah. Okay. With that, I will close this. Do you have any half-minute question before we break? So that when we come back, we can fully devote on end our discussion. Case. Any half-minute question, 1 minute question before we break? What part of what I discussed in LBO so far, you had covered in other courses, any of the financial or other courses, financial M&A courses? Anyone?
I think the financial part of it was somehow covered in a couple of other courses. So the strategic part, at least for me, the strategic part was rather new.
Okay. So this cash on cash, as I have explained. Mohak?
Yes, sir. To some extent, sir, did cover. And we had a guest lecture. We had a guest lecturer who also mentioned COC.
Okay. Good. So some more issues will be clear when we discuss that case next year after the break. Any other half minute question? Anybody else other than Mohak? Any other point that you covered that I have repeated here? Any other point? No, nobody wants to say anything. Okay, see you. Then we have break. It is now 12:54 at 13 minutes. 107. 107, we will meet, keeping 2 minutes for our attendance. Okay, break. Which are the groups making presentations today?
So group 3 is presenting for yes.
Group 2 for no.
This is endo. Group 3 for solution, group 4 for case story, right?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
And group 3 and 2 for the arguments, right?
Yes, sir.
What is the exact question, group 3 and 2? Group 3 and 2, what is the exact question?
Group 3 is, should Endo make the decision to merge with Algo?
Oh, yes. Okay.
Okay, sir. So group 4 here, sir. Should we start with the story?
I did not close the attendance because only 36 responded. After 3 minutes, I will stop that.
Okay, sir.
Okay, the question is, should oblique can Endo acquire Algos, right? Okay, I think it's about 3 minutes. Only 37 responded. That means some are going to be absent. If anyone did not see the poll, please send a chat message immediately. Okay, end poll. Yeah, now group 4 can start your presentation.
Sure, sir.
What happened, my God? Ah, okay, done.
Good afternoon. We are group 4 and we'll be discussing the facts in the Endo Pharma case. We start by looking at the history of Endo Pharma, the origin of a buyout. Endo started in 1920 as a family-owned business. In 1969, DuPont acquired Endo to enter the pharma industry. In 1993, DuPont Merck named its generic business Endo Laboratories LLC with Carol Emmon as its president. In 1996, the CEO of DuPont Merck approached Carol for assistance with company's non-promoted brands and generic markets. Carol proposed divesting, followed by a management buyout. Carol, along with two of her colleagues, met with 7 private equity firms and chose Kelso and Company. Kelso and Company was established in 1971 with the aim of facilitating acquisitions and equity investment in companies with ESOPs. Although Kelso had no prior experience with pharmaceutical companies, they pursued the deal because of the confidence they had in Carol and her colleagues. The MBO was, the management buyout was completed 9 months later, and in 1997, Endo began operations after equity investment from Kelso and Company. The deal structure involved 3 different classes of stock options, and the total purchase price was $277 million, out of which $110 million was through equity. 94 by Kelso and the remainder by 3 founders and Smith Barney. Moving on to the next slide. Next slide, please. We look at the strategy of Endo Pharma. So the product strategy that they followed focused on specialty products in pain management. They have 35 products in their portfolio, out of which 10 are branded, but they are no longer protected by a patent. 25 are generic drugs. Proprietary products were marked under the label of Endo Laboratories and generic products as Endo Generic Products. despite the fact that Endo had 35 products in their portfolio. The emphasis was on Percocet. Now, the aim was to create different Percocet dosages to revitalize the brand and reinvest the profit in a sophisticated branded pipeline with patent protection. Coupled with its 25 scientists in Long Island R&D centers. Endo's strategy was to hold prices down by entering into multi-year contracts with suppliers and distributors. Endo's products were originally produced by DuPont Merck with Farmflex providing sales reps. The company intended to grow in four ways, which will be discussed further in detail by Nehal.
Sure.
So in this slide, we'll look at the four growth strategies which Endo adopted. So the first one is the life cycle management. So in this, Endo particularly wanted to extend the life cycle of their existing products through new product variants. So they currently had the Percocet, which was 5 mg HCl and also 325 mg acetaminophen. But there was no different dosages which was available in the market, which was in demand. As a result, Endo wanted invested in R&D staff to create those difficult new formulations which was needed by the market. So next strategy was the new generic segment. So what Endo thought was, by bringing these new generic versions of other companies' products to the market, it could discourage other competitors from entering into the market. So currently, there was MS content, and Endo looked at the opportunity of getting OxyContin in generic into the picture because it had a huge growth opportunity ahead, and it would serve as a generic to MS-Contin. Then the third strategy was licensed products. So by actively pursuing the in-licensing of these proprietary products, Endo thought that it could produce the near-term product revenues and have a portfolio of proprietary drugs. So it launched Lidoderm in September 1999. So it got a 7-year marketing exclusivity in United States for the distribution of the Lidoderm. And the last strategy was a proprietary R&D. So we can see that Endo's spending on the R&D increased significantly. It was 5.9 million in 1998, it reached 9.4 million and it was in 1999, and it was expected to reach 26 million by 2000. So this increased spending on R&D, and also Emon appointed Lee as an assistant to increase the R&D innovations which is happening in their department. This was just in a hope to develop new breakthrough products in the area of pain management. Next slide, please.
So we will discuss about pain management industry. So pain management as a discipline began only in 1973. Before this, there was no such focus study around it. So FDA had approved first drug, which was oxycodone for pain relief, which was used in combination with aspirin. Then in 1973, another drug, acetaminophen, was approved along with oxycodone. So beginning in 1990s, a group of healthcare practitioners had called for liberalization of pain management industry, mostly because earlier the hesitancy was that these pain management drugs are very addictive in nature, so there was risk of substance abuse. But then because of increased R&D and increased study on patients, they, a lot more things were understood about these drugs. And so they wanted this industry to get more liberalized, which is why they had petitioned the FDA for the same. Also, Algos Pharmaceutical was one such industry which was in the best position to entirely revolutionize this industry. Obviously, if the required approvals were given. So yeah, next slide.
Yes, so now the biggest question comes whether Algos and Endo should be merged into a common entity, and whether this LBO should be processed further. So recently, Algo had come up with Morphidex, which promised a lot of new things in the pain management zone. They promised double the effectiveness of managing pain, as well as double the sustained release period as well. So it was a great medicine, but in the phase 3 trials, it was not approved by FDA. And Algo's stock price fell by more than half in August 1999 due to this non-approval by FDA. Endo has been profitable and the sales has been growing. This could also be looked at as a good opportunity for Endo to merge with Algos, since it is a nice opportunity due to Algos' lower stock price. And this could be beneficial for Endo in the long run. But Endo is anyways planning an IPO within a year. And an IPO will, with the roadshow, will bring in a lot of new investors. It will also bring a lot of fame to the company, and it also allows the people who hold the stock to quickly liquidate their position and get the profits. But if they go ahead with the merger, it would silently be converted into a public company, so without an IPO, and the dilution of and deferment of the equity options would take a lot more years, because it won't come up with the charm of an IPO. Also, the cost of merger would be very high compared to a straightforward IPO. So looking at these considerations, we have to understand whether Endo and Algo should be merged with an LBO process or not.
Done?
Yes, sir.
Okay, good. So we have all the important points here in the story. Now, shall we go to discuss the question? Should / can Endo acquire Algos? This is Yes Group.
Yes, sir. Is my screen visible?
Sure, sure. You can also maximize if you want.
Yeah, so we are Group 3 and we are covering the benefits. So we are putting forth the case for Algo merging with Endo. Talking about the benefits of the merger, that's obviously related diversification. The firm is, Endo is focused, and the merger would provide benefits through inorganic growth. So it's mentioned in the case that Algo's research and clinical testing infrastructure would accelerate Endo's move into new product development, which is one of the four growth elements that is being targeted by Endo. So Algo had recently tried to get approval for Morphidex, as was mentioned by the previous group, and which and after that particular drug had failed in phase three, their stock price had dropped, which meant that the price of acquisition would be significantly low. So Endo has enough cash reserve of the approval. In addition, Algo has, it's also mentioned that Algo has enough reserves for at least one more phase three trial. Although like a retrial, petitioning for a retrial would incur costs, like Algo has enough reserves to take care of that. Endo also has expertise in working with FDA on analgesics and narcotics. And they have already a past experience of getting difficult drug approvals. So they might be well suited to, you know, bring Morphidex to the market after sorting out the approval issue. And the merger would also help Endo expand into the range of pain management categories. And the Algos technologies were unique in that. Actually, Aman has been quoted saying this, the CEO of Endo has been quoted saying that if Algos technology works, you would have equivalent analgesia with half the narcotic. So the result of the reduction in pain could be achieved with half the narcotic input. So this could, in combination with the Endo's existing products, could produce a whole new class of drugs that could obsolete all of the existing pain management products. So the payoffs are huge. And through the merger, Endo could also become a public company and enjoy the benefits of raising capital from the market. This is how we have, we propose that they should go about buying. It should, so to capitalize on the reduction in Algo stock price, we recommend an all stock deal where stockholders of Algo receive a proportionate stake in the merged entity based on a pre-decided exchange rate. Uncertainty regarding Morphidex's FDA approval and Endo's impressive top line growth can be used to structure the deal more favorably to Endo. Additionally, the stockholders of Algo can be given warrants that are conditional that can be exercised only if Morphidex gets approved by the FDA. And these warrants can have the embedded option to purchase an additional stake in the merged entity. Along similar lines, Endo stockholders can also receive warrants that if Morphidex doesn't get FDA approval, they have the option to, you know, get a bigger stake in the merged entity. So that's all.
Done.
Yeah.
You have answered all the parts of the question?
To my knowledge, yes, sir.
Okay. Group two. Yeah, that should they acquire? You have given very clear arguments.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
So our argument is no, like they shouldn't go ahead with the merger. Basically, there are several risks associated.
You can maximize. Abhishek, you can maximize if you want.
Yes, just.
Go ahead, no problem. I have no issue. Go ahead.
Okay, sir.
Done. Okay.
Yeah, so there are several risks as I was trying to explain. So first ones are the operation risk. I mean, as we've observed, there is no approvable letter given to the drugs from Algo. So there were clinical trials, risk of failure of those trials as we go ahead. And again, like CapEx and R&D issues in operations. I mean, if they go ahead with this decision of merger, then there is very little, there is a huge amount of restrictions on the working capital for existing projects or new projects that they would like to go ahead with. And also the focus of the company and executives would be more on turning around Algo's operations and trials instead of focusing on their existing operations or new pipeline. The other one is the financial risk. I mean, instead of going ahead with IPO, if they go ahead with merger, the cost of merger would be high, as it will be explained later on coming slides. The cash flows was also an issue from Algo's merger point of view. I mean, in 2001, they are expected to start earning revenue. And till 2001, there would be no revenue, only costs would be incurred, which would reduce the EPS for Algo. And the stock prices are also too volatile right now. I mean, although the stock prices were high initially, but due to FDA approvals, they have gone down. And in future also, the expectation of volatility is very high. So this gives a very negative incentive for investors as well as the private equity firm. Then the strategic risks are also too high. They're going ahead with large investment in one particular product portfolio. The requirement for the merger is more from Algo side and less from Eldo side. So if they can renegotiate the merger conditions and exit conditions with Algo, I don't think they should go ahead with this from strategic point of view. And also Endo can explore other options, other investment options instead of going ahead just with Algo. If there are certain new competitors who can come in and provide the same capabilities at lower price of merger, then they can explore those options as well. The last one is obviously the implementation risks. The major risk is coming from the PE firm, since already they invested in 97, around 97, and by 2001, they'll be entering their exit horizon. So PE firm might not go ahead with this kind of deal, which might dilute their ownership in the company, as well as risks associated with the fall in share prices. They were expecting 3 to 12 times of returns. And with this merger going ahead and the uncertainty going ahead, they might not materialize the expected exit that they had with Endo. Yeah, the next part will be taken up by Madhurima.
Yeah, so there are certain strategic disadvantages if Endo goes with taking this deal forward with Algo. So as we have seen, Endo has already a very steady flow of revenue and it has been a very profitable firm. So this kind of an acquisition will disrupt the smooth cash flow that is there in the firm. And because at the present moment, the Morphidex has already seen a non-approval, has already got a non-approval letter from the FDA. So there is not much strong growth expectation also from Algo, and the growth expectation that is there in Endo might be disrupted because of this kind of merger or this kind of acquisition that will take place. So, and also we have seen that the revenue synergies from Morphidex is only realizable from 2001. So immediately there won't be any benefit that Endo will get from Algo. Next slide, please. So following the FDA's decision of they are not approving the Morphidex phase 3 trial, we see the stock price of Algo fell more than half. So this also speaks for the investors' lack of confidence in Algo. And also it talks about the intrinsic value of the firm, which is not so greatly valued by investors. So this lack of confidence will also be there if these two companies go away, move forward with the deal. Also, in the case, it was said that a merger will dilute the ownership position of Endo's current investors. So that will also be of a disadvantage to Endo as a firm. And after such kind of an merger, if we see management focus and time post this kind of merger will be more focused towards the recovery of the stressed company. So that will take away management's time and they won't be able to focus on the ongoing operations of the firm. So obviously, given these strategic disadvantages and already where there are signals of failure, we don't think that Endo as a firm should move forward with this deal with Algo. So on the next slide will be taken by Kazi.
Yeah, so one of the major disadvantages was that the cost of merger was very high compared to the cost of going for an IPO for Endo. So if you look at the peer comparison for Algo, we took four firms which didn't have a negative 1 year forward EPS and tried to project their 5 year forward EPS using the growth rate provided in the case. And we went ahead to derive the average industry forward PE multiple, 5 year forward PE multiple. And from there, the intrinsic value at which we arrived for Algo was around 426 million. And if we assume that it's an all cash deal with no premium provided to the shareholders, looking at the current market value, it was 322 million. So the cost of merger stands at around 104 million, which if you compare to the cost of IPO for Endo, it would be around 6 to 7% of the total deal size, which accounts for around 30 to 40 million, which is significantly higher. So we can say that the cost of merger, which is 104 million, is significantly higher than the cost of acquisition. Moving on to the next slide. So this is what happened in the real scenario, that in July 2000, Endo Pharmaceutical actually acquired.
1 minute, Sripur. That is not now required. We are not yet. We have not yet discussed this. You should never do that. Okay. Our decision is to our task is to decide as a manager based on available information, right?
Yes.
And today we are deciding, and tomorrow what happened, we are not gods to know, right?
Yes.
I used to tell this again and again. So we should never bother about that. We, as a manager, should analyze the information and decide what is the right thing for us.
Yes.
Then only you will become better decision maker, right? Strategic decision maker. Okay. Yeah.
Yes.
That at the end you can give that because when we give the summary in the next session.
Sure.
Oh. Done?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. So both sides are very clearly focused the argument, but both of you forgot to missed the catch in the question. Okay, we will examine that catch in the question a little later. Okay. Now let's go to discuss the game. Let me do the share screen. Okay. Right. So let's start with a question, right? So that we come back to the story. I'll split the question, which was asked to the two groups. So the first part of my question will be straightforward. Should Endo acquire Algos? The two groups which responded yes, no, need not respond. Okay. So if you have already done, I will recast the question. Meaning relaunch the poll. I have relaunched the poll. Okay. Those two groups need not participate. Those who said yes and no. First, I'm going to take it off in a few seconds. Some people not responding to the question will give an implication that they did not read the case. Okay. 20 people responded, which is half of the class. End point. One third said no. Don't go for it. Two thirds said yes. Okay. Now let's start with those who said yes. Those who said yes, please raise your hand. Those who said yes, 13 people said yes, please raise your hand. Yeah. Chitran.
So, should they acquire in this scenario? I have 3 points to elaborate. So, The first reason being the new technology in the narcotic system, which is with the algo, it can prove very significant in the market and can lead to existential crisis for the endo system as of now. So, for that,
what you are saying, competitive threat.
It is kind of a competitive threat. Yes, sir.
Competitive threat. That is
the current market may be absorbed completely by Algo's new technology
advanced product, right?
Yes, sir. And second reason is this is the right time to acquire or have a partnership with Algo because the stock price has reduced owing to that phase 3 clinical trial failures. So it can take advantage at this point. And the third point itself is the competitive advantage, resource complementarity between Algo and Endo. So Endo is kind of expert in getting patent licensed or approved from the FDA. So it could use this expertise to get Algo, that clinical trial process expedited.
Okay. Resource pooling, right?
Yes, sir. Resource pooling can happen. Or synergies could be used.
Okay. Yeah, that is resource pooling or synergies. Pooja.
Sir, I think that merging with Algos is something like related diversification. Also, if it doesn't merge with Algos, then there is a considerable threat that someone else company might acquire it, and it might pose a competitive threat to Endos in the long run.
Rivals might acquire. Yes. This is, you are talking about diversified growth, right?
Yes.
Is it diversified growth or is it the same? Is it a diversification because both are pain management products?
Sir, related diversification.
Meaning horizontal integration, right?
Yes.
Horizontal integration. a new product segment, right?
Yes.
Piyush.
Sir, Endo can help Algo to do a trial and receive FDA approval for their drug as they have stuck in the final approval process. So Endo can help Algo to go through this stage.
Endo expertise in FDA.
And it will also help. Yes, sir.
And yes, by implication, you are saying the benefit will go to benefit of Morphitex, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. That is from Piyush. Mrunmayee.
Sir, Endo is also in the financial position to do so. It is already debt-free and it is also generating a lot of cash. So,
is it a debt-free?
Almost, like they have returned the debt they had taken. It's mentioned in the case. So,
completely?
No, not completely. But then they do have a lot of cash. So they are in the position that they could invest.
How much is the return? How much is the return?
I need to check.
How much?
They have a total debt of 191203 as on 1999. So almost half.
They took a debt of 165, right? 167. Out of that, how much paid? What is the balance in 1998?
Oh, they have increased rather. Yeah, 170, showing 170,000.
170 is the debt, right? 170 million.
Million, yeah.
$1 million, which is substantial, right?
Yeah. But they do have like good cash.
How much?
So the sales cash was 20. Yeah, it was 22,000 in 1999, grown from 14,000 in 1997.
22 million, right?
Yeah, 22.
Dollar 22 million. Which is this is the final one? 1999.
Yeah.
Which means even after utilizing cash, still they will have 140.
Net debt would be less, yes.
Right? Yeah. Okay. So, but you are saying in those healthy finances, but then we have this part also. As yes, an utilizing sir. Factor. Cash is positive, right? Shubham.
Yes, sir. They complemented each other. Firstly, like Endo would help them get regulatory approvals, and Algos was very strong technologically, which Endo was lacking. So they used to complement each other. Also, financially, they were complementing each other because Endo was doing good financially, and Algos had been having very marginal profit. This would be a good time to have
Algos have profits.
No, I mean, they were not, I don't remember exactly, but they were not doing good financially, is what I remember. Yeah.
They don't have any revenues.
Exactly. So, it was in trial stages. Yeah. So, this would be a good time to take us to do a strategic alliance, because it would be financially beneficial for from Endo's point of view. So, this would be a good time to go for alliance.
Ankit?
Sir, I have majority of the... Sir, first of all, related diversification. Acquiring a pharmaceutical company won't be that difficult. That would eventually help them to increase their product line. Mm-hmm. And, sir, secondly, the price, the share price of Algo was not was dropping that time, so this was the best time to acquire the company.
Okay, you are agreeing with all the other thing. Any other new thing, Nehal?
Sir, Endo, after acquiring it, Endo would easily become a public company because the IPO it could easily offer an IPO within a year.
No, if it is already public company, it cannot offer IPO.
No. As in, Endo was not a public company, sir. But after the acquisition, it can easily become a public company because of algos.
Without IPO itself, right?
Yeah.
But is it good or bad?
Sir, they say later that it is cost. I mean, the cost of merger was considerably high.
So, is it good or bad? Not good, no? Whatever. Yeah. Abhishek. I think some chat messages are also there. What is that? Incrementally on R&D and merging with algos in boost. Okay, who is saying this? Abhishek, you have a problem with it. And has been spending incrementally on R&D and merging with will boost the development process of new drugs. Okay, so you have already got. That is financial part and R&D, right? That's what he is saying. Okay, so these points are clear. And on the other side, no groups. Please remove all your hands. I have taken up all of you. No group, please. Sorry, not no group. And those who said no, 7 people said no. Please raise your hand. Nehal, Ankit, Shubham, please remove your hands. Shubham, Ankit, Nehal, please remove your hand. Let others raise their hand. Ankit and Nehal, please remove your hand. Nehal, are you able to hear? Ankit, are you able to hear? What happened to them? Nehal, can you hear? Ankit, can you hear? Please remove your hand. Ankit. Yeah, Zahil.
Sir, I just wanted to highlight one important point here, which is regarding the FDA approval. So from my previous experience in the pharma industry, there is a thing that once a drug actually is not approved, it's very hard to get it approved again. So with that risk being involved, it would be a very risky thing that this company is acquired. So just wanted to put that point across.
Okay, risk of reapproval once they are rejected, right? Vaibhav.
Sir, yes, that was one of the points I was going to say. Apart from that, we have to understand that Endo has a great track record of increasing their sales. They have great drugs upcoming. They have been investing in R&D. So an IPO can be a very good thing for the shareholders as well as the company. And we know that pharma is a capital heavy. You invest into R&D a lot and the money is recovered after maybe 10 years. So an IPO could be better in increasing, getting that much funding to invest in R&D and taking the organization further. So I think the focus should be on that, not a silent listing due to merger with Algo.
Sir, similar point. One more thing was that, as mentioned in the case, that Endo stock options, because of a merger, the Endo stock options, that would not dilute Algo's public stock options, but Algo's Endo's current investors' stock positions would be diluted and their ownership would be affected. And next would be that as Vaibhav has mentioned, that there would be considerable cash outlays for phase 3 clinical trials where heavy R&D is involved, and an IPO could be a solution in that sense more than a merger.
Yeah. This would be a very important aspect, right? Cash outlays and issues associated with that. Okay, so we have gotten both sides. We know what are the arguments mainly coming forth. The yes group or no group, do you have any point that we missed? Yes group or no group? Any point we missed? No group. Did we miss any important point? Group two?
Sir, I guess the point of view of exit from fees perspective should be also taken into consideration.
Everything, which one?
Exit of fees, sir. I mean, they ending the horizon, like they're very close to the exit horizon. So it should be also taken into consideration while making this decision. I mean, where they invested close to 90 million. So they would be looking at good amount of exit.
Yeah. Okay. Now let's go back. Okay. Now both sides have given your views. Now let me ask the second question. What is the question? Can they acquire? That part was the catch, but none of you, group 2 and 3, did not pay attention to that part. Can they acquire? That is one thing. Now, okay. So let's go to people. Those who want to contribute, you can raise your hand, but I will go to people who are in the queue who did not so far participate, right? Okay, Smriti. Smriti, you are there? Smriti, you are not there? Not responding means, yeah, at least you are.
So she is there on chat.
Chat is there?
So she responded on chat.
Yeah, Smriti, can you speak? Mic not working. Video is also not working. Ayushi.
Yes, sir.
Ayushi, you have read the case, isn't it? Ayushi, you have read the case? Ayushi, where is she? Saurabh. Those who did not read the case, please send messages that I did not read so that I don't have to call. Those who did not read the case, please send a message to me so I don't have to call you. Saurabh is not there. Saurabh is not there. Sandeep. Yeah, Sandeep. Speak, Sandeep. If you don't want to be called, please send a chat message.
Sir, Sandeep is also on chat, sir.
Sorry?
Sir, Sandeep is also on chat.
Nee, mic not working. Everybody is saying mic not. I don't believe it. If you did not read the case, please send a message to me that, I did not read the case. Nirbhay.
Yes, sir.
Nirbhay. See, yes, sir. Let's go back to the origin of Endo, right?
Sir, Smriti is saying, I was able to connect.
But now somebody else is online.
Yes,
Nirbhay.
Sorry.
Nirbhay.
Yes, sir.
Let's go back. In which year the LBO took place? Nirbhay.
Yes, sir.
In which year LBO took place for Endo?
Sir, 1993, I think.
1997. Okay. That itself is not the point. 1997. And when is the exit by Kelso?
No. Sir, just a minute.
It is not 8 to 10 years.
Sir, I think it was 3 years.
3 to 5 years.
3 to 5 years.
5 years. Chitra, it is 3 to 5 years. Yeah, mid years, 3 to 5 years. Right. So, when is the exit period? Suppose we take 5 years, then it will be, 3 years, it will be
2002.
Or 2002, right?
Yes.
In 5 years, 2002. Clear?
Yes.
Now, Mohit, Mradmai, you are able to, Smriti, you are able to come now? Smriti, you are able to come now?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Smriti.
I believe, sir, they can acquire.
No, I'm asking specifically. That is, just now Nirbhay said LBO 97 and exit 3 to 5 years. Well, that means 2000-2002, right? So what is the total debt in 1999, right? Story group, the debt of 170 is in 1999? Story group?
No, sir. 170 is in 1997.
97?
Oh, 98. I'm sorry.
98.
Total 98, debt of 170.
It is $170, right?
Yes, sir.
70 million. And minus that year cash was 22, right? Which means the net debt remaining is 148 million.
So cash that year was less than 22. In 98, the cash was 17.
17 only. 98. Okay. So 17 million, which is 153, right? Clear? And what is the Smriti? Agree? Smriti?
Yes, sir.
Is it agreed? Although others have answered, but do you agree? Mohit?
Yes, sir.
Mohit, now?
Yes, sir.
So can you
repeat what is the profit? What is the profit?
So in the year 1997 or 99?
98. 97 started. 98 was the first full year. 98, what was the profit?
Sir, I don't think there was a profit in the 1998. They were paying interest on loan.
They have data. No, they have data. Anyone else? What is this 201?
The 2 lakh, the 2 lakh 1,000 something.
2 lakh 1,000 or 2 million? It is 2 million.
2 million, yes, sir.
Because they have given it in thousands, no? 2 million, sir. Was the profit 2 million? This is who Mohit is saying. Who?
Yes, sir. Mohit, sir.
$2 million is the profit, right? Now, is there a projection of 99 profit?
I think it's 3.2 million is there, I guess.
2.2
million. I'm not sure, sir, on this regard.
Anybody can help?
Sir, it was 0.2 million in 1998. 0.2, sir. And in 1999, it was 3.2.
99, it was?
3.26 million.
3.26 million.
Yes, sir.
And 99. And what is the revenue project? Out of how much? 99, what is the revenue?
138.
This is, who is saying this? Chitra?
Yes, sir.
No, who is saying this? 138.
So, Chitrang, this
side. Chitrang, okay. Chitrang, revenue of 1999.
Yes, sir. It was estimated to be 138 million.
138 million. Whereas in the previous years, it was between 100 and 110, 100 and 105, right?
Yes, 108 in 1998.
100 in 1998, it was 100. Or 108, no?
Yes, sir.
8 million. And are there projections about the future profit and future sales? 2000, 2001, 2002?
So not for
in the exhibits, anyone
only needs for Algo, sir.
Sorry,
only for Algo, not for Endo.
Endo, it is not there. Now, what do you think logically? Let me ask Pooja S. Is there? Pooja S is there? Pooja S is not there. Mit.
Yes, sir.
Mit. Now, 2002. What do you think would be the revenue in 2002 if they don't go for any acquisition, Endo?
Sir, that data is not provided.
Yeah, but through statistical extrapolation, last 2 years it is 100 something, and this year it is projected to be 138. So, what do you think would be the projection of revenue? Can it be 1000?
10% more than the previous year.
Yeah, it would be somewhere, say, for instance, suppose 150 it comes and 170 it comes, like that, right?
Yes, sir.
We can't expect it to be more than that?
No, sir.
Isn't it? And Amen. Amen is there? Amen is not there. Divya?
Yes, sir.
Divya, what do you think would be the profit at this rate?
So
for the next 2 years? You don't have to be exact. I'm saying some wild guess, given this relationship of 2 years.
Yes, sir. So somewhere around 5% of the revenue, I guess.
It is only 2%. In 1999, when the revenue increased so much, the profit is just 2.5%, right?
Yes, sir. 2.5%.
So even if we think that the profit could be in 2000, 5%, both years 5%, what it could be? 7.5 million? And the subsequent year, 8.5 million? In the best scenario, which is unlikely to happen, 5%, right?
Right, so.
Now, we don't need any analysis, right? So, by 2002, is there a way of repaying the debt of 153 million using this cash flow?
No, sir. Seems unlikely.
So, even if we take this as the net income, is there any gross profit given there? Operating margin?
Yes, sir. It's given.
Is there an operating margin group? Vishwan? Vishwan?
Yes, sir.
Is there an operating margin given there, which is before EBITDA? EBITDA, yes. Is before, yes, interest payment.
Yeah.
In 1999, is there an EBITDA?
Yeah, it's 80 million, sir.
80?
Yes, 80 million.
80? And is there any data for interest payment or other?
Yeah, interest expense is around 14.3 million.
Which one, interest?
Sorry, 19.7 million. That is the interest expense.
Interest is 19.7 million.
Yeah.
19.7 million. Is there an amortization data? Amortization?
Amortization is around 8.3 million.
$8.3. So 27, 20, this together is 26, right?
Sorry, interest expense is 14.3.
Interest expense.
Yeah, 14.3 and
8.3. That's 22.3. Which means it is about 23 million. Amortization and interest payment is about 23 million,
right?
Yes, sir. So if that we escalate to some 25 million and then to 30 million, in the subsequent revenue, still will the 2 years that payment completely remove the debt? This is Vishwan, right? What will be the total? Gandhar.
Yes.
So our total would be the 14 million was 98 or 99, which means 2 years. So we have 98, 23 million, 23 plus 25 plus 30. Plus our total profit. How much is the total profit?
So 8.5 we have estimated.
Yeah, we have estimated about 16, right? 16. Yes. Profit. If we give all this, how much will be the total? 48.
So 94.
94. And what is the debt? Debt?
So 153.
153 is still remaining, right? 153, yes. Which means about 59 will be, that means 59 will be million will be the debt remaining, even in 2002, right?
Yes, sir.
When they had to get out of the LBO, right?
Yes, sir.
Therefore, when Endo did not even completely repay the debt and cash is only to be used for debt clearance as per the LBO provisions, is there a scope for acquiring? Gautam, I want all of you to raise your hand. Whoever wants to come back to raise your hand. Now we are going to discuss the possibility of the possibility or impossibility of hands. Raise your hands for participating. Oh, it is already 2. Oh, I did not see the watch. Yes, Saifur. Saifur?
Yes, sir.
Then if this much debt is still remaining and 2002 Kelso has to exit, because 3 to 5 means 2002 will be that 5 years. Without repaying the complete debt, whereas as per the LBO, the cash can only be used for the
service
payments, can they really acquire?
No, sir.
So what should we do? What should we do? It cannot acquire, right? Because as per the terms and conditions of the LBO, cash can only be used for repayment of debt. Then only on quitting, they will be able to realize maximum value and their return X is dependent on that. But since so much of debt is remaining, can they divert the cash for anything else? No, it cannot.
No.
So Chitrang, okay, Saifur, you want to guess what then they should do? What is the remedy?
Sir, I would suggest a different deal structure, a different deal mix.
But what is the first step even in considering this acquisition? Chitrang, with that we will close this discussion because time is already out. Chitrang.
Yes, sir. So they may.
What should she do, Kerala man?
Sir, she may go for debt restructuring. Like so much debt
to
is.
To who?
There.
To who? Where?
Sir, she may either like there are three top people in the management founders. So they may.
She should request debt restructure?
Okay, sir. Here Kelso is the company which has.
Yes, they have to approach the PE firm that is Kelso for complete revisit of the structure, funding structure, right?
Yes.
And they should provide more funding, right?
Yes, sir. Yeah, they can.
Should allow Endo to have more provide Endo more funding. Without their more funding, can they do? They have to revisit the terms and conditions of the LBO and restructure the LBO. Whereby they may or either waive off the obligation to use the cash flow for repaying the debt or restructure the debt with the more funding, right?
Yes, sir.
So, is there any other way to approach this before we consider the acquisition?
Sir, one possibility I was thinking was this Medimax, the other drug, they can ask for licensing it or may have some strategic partnership to help the other company Elgo go through those verification process and acquire some sort of licensing or internal agreement.
Okay. So what you are saying is if they should first approach Kelso and if Kelso is not able to agree to this kind of dilution, then they should go for alternative, which is partner alliance, right?
Yes, sir.
So this is what you are saying. Avik, what you said? Yes, wouldn't Kelso, that is why Kelso has to agree. Now, if Kelso sees that their IRR will be better, their X will be better with the Algos acquired, and they may have to wait a few more years for realizing this, or they may sell this to somebody else, PE firm, and they will quit. But their valuation would be better with Algos, they will agree for it. But if they don't want any kind of dilution and they don't think Algos valuation, acquiring Algos will add to their valuation and X, return X, cash on cash X, they will not agree to it, right? But whatever it is, the first point is that Kerala Amman cannot take this decision without going back to Kelso. This is no longer a strategic decision. Actually, this is a financial decision in the first place. Then only it will be a strategic decision. Only if Kelso permits Amman, she will be able to go for the strategic decision. Otherwise, this LBO is restricting Kerala Amman from going for a pure strategic decision. That is how the LBO will affect a strategic decision. That is what we wanted to show. So here our discussion point was not about the strategic decision. Our discussion point was how this LBO provisions would be restricting the strategic action, right? So with that, we will close. In the next session, we will have a summary. All the best. See you. Bye.